Hello and welcome to Lutz and Glory. I'm Bronwyn.
I'm Will.
And I'm Kathy. And this is the first part of our recap of the 2016 World Figure Skating Championships that took place in Boston. We're going to start things off with the men's event. So winning the title for the second year in a row was Javier Fernandez of Spain. Two really great, clean performances from Javi. Such a well-deserved title, and all around just great skating, great showmanship, and great athleticism from him. And what did you guys think of his result?
I thought his long program was the best performance he's ever put out in his career. All the jumps were just stunning, and about halfway, and it was right after Yuzuru's long program performance, which we will get to, but like about halfway through Javi's performance, I was like sitting there, my jaw was dropped open. I was like, oh my god, he's going to win.
Yeah.
And it just, I was like, I kept kind of waiting, because obviously we know Javi's not the most consistent skater, so I just kind of kept waiting, like, is he going to fall? I hope he doesn't fall, but is he going to? He might, he still could. And then it kept getting better and better, and I was so impressed. It wasn't his best short program performance. He did count a fall. He still got a 98, which I still kind of question, but not that big of a deal in the long run, because the long program was more than enough to ensure him the world title. I was very, very impressed.
Yeah, one of the things that I think plagues a lot of skaters like Javier is like showmen and show women like Javier, is that they focus so much on the performance that they like run into trouble once they get to the jumps, because they're so focused on the performance that they don't quite know when to harness in their focus and do a jump. And he found this like magnificent balance between like emoting and grabbing the audience and also seamlessly doing the jumps. I mean, like, the jumps were gorgeous. He has innate technique, and like people sometimes forget that because he's just so like flamboyant and irreverent in his performance. That long program was quite the sight. I mean, it was unbelievable. And it just kept building. It was unreal. For any doubters and any naysayers that said that last year's title was a fluke, he proved them wrong, I think. And it was funny, after Yuzuru's score was posted for the free, I was like, that's beatable. Because Kathy and I were actually, we were there to witness it live in Boston, and that was unbelievable. But when they posted the score, it was Javier, he had to be clean. He had to be relatively clean, but we knew he could do it, and he did just that. He really did seize the moment. It was fantastic.
I think what really impressed me about Javi's free skate, especially, is that in the past we've sort of seen him maybe struggle here and there with the second half jumps. You know, he kind of loses steam, and that's really a common issue with a lot of skaters. That waning stamina as you get near the end of your program, but I felt that wasn't an issue at all here. It was almost like he built up more and more energy towards the end, which sounds really counterintuitive because you're getting tired, obviously. But the crowd was with him, obviously. The energy was there, the enthusiasm, the dedication to the choreography, and he just carried it the whole way through. And I think that's what makes it's such a memorable performance for me.
Yeah, it really was the full pack. Like, he had everything. He did everything he possibly could have in that free skate. And it paid dividends. It was fantastic. Let's move on to the silver medalist, the 2014 world champion and reigning Olympic champion, Yuzuru Hanyu from Japan. It was looking like it was another title. After the short program, it was looking like another world championship performance for Hanyu. Not quite the world record that we saw, but 110.5 whatever is nothing to scoff at. And, you know, I found it interesting. He got a level 3 for his step sequence, so that could have been the difference. that likely was the difference between him breaking that world record threshold and not. But really, it was looking like his title to lose. He had a 12-point lead over Javier, and like a 16-point lead over Patrick Chen. He was way out in front. And I wouldn't say he threw it away, necessarily, but I feel like it was an uncharacteristically shaky skate. He just had, like, scattered errors, and it looked like, I mean, based on NHK, I mean, like, we have to give Yuzuru, like, a pass, honestly. Like, he's put together clean performance after clean performance after clean performance this season, and he's really come into his own and just skated to his full potential. Obviously, he holds the world record in all three portions of the IJS scoring. So that said, though, it was a bit disappointing to see the free skate. And it did, I don't know, I mean, the performance itself did kind of suffer. It wasn't as sharp or as crisp, especially in the footwork in the second half, because that's supposed to be just like a victory run, honestly, after he lands all the jumps, that footwork. And it was a bit disappointing, performance-wise and technique-wise. What did you guys think of Hanyu?
I definitely agree with you that it was a bit disappointing. He only had two clean competitions this season, if you think about it. He had NHK, and he had Grand Prix Final. And then he kind of came back down to earth the Japanese Nationals, which, of course, he was going to win Japanese Nationals. But we haven't seen him compete since then. And so nobody really knew, because he didn't go to Four Continents, nobody really knew what we were going to see from him. So it was kind of off. It's kind of unfair to compare, because we had two beautiful performances of that long program, and I will stand by the fact that that is probably the best program of his career by far. It is so good. It works so well for him.
Mm-hmm.
But when you come down to it, it just didn't have the same magic as it did earlier in the season with the clean performances. It was a bit of a disappointment, and I know, knowing what his personality is like that I've seen through interviews and everything, he cannot be happy right now. So I expect to see him come back with a vengeance, even stronger than he did this season, because he was disappointed about losing the title last year. Losing it another year in a row, if I were in his shoes, I wouldn't be happy either.
I think what's important to remember is that, you know, in the middle of all of these world records that he's set, the fact that he's a reigning Olympic champion, it's so easy to forget that he's still fallible. And when he's at his best, he can obviously be the best in the world, as we've seen. But, you know, we can't let the fact that he's been so good in the past erase the fact that he's human and he's prone to mistakes just like everybody else. And so, you know, it shouldn't come as that much of a shock to us that he faltered here, even though I feel like the expectations and the reality are kind of, there's kind of a disparity. But still, you know, even with the mistakes that he made, still second in the world, you know, nothing to scoff at. And I think that, like Will mentioned earlier, the mistakes that he made were just really uncharacteristic, in the sense that he usually pops jumps, or he just like ditches it in the middle completely when he knows that he's not going to have a secure landing. But here we saw him step out of jumps, we saw him under-rotate things, and it was like, I mean, you can imagine that the pressure on him must be immense, and so that makes me think that this was a matter of him maybe wanting it too much, or feeling the culmination of having a season with such highs and lows, and having the pressure of just capping it off on a good note, I think.
Yeah, I feel like you can sort of liken it to the same hype that was surrounding Patrick before the Olympics in Sochi. Because he put out world record performances at Trophy Eric Bompard that Olympic year, And it was like, he's perfect, he's going to win the Olympic gold medal, and then he didn't. And it's sort of the same thing, how, like, just because he's a human being and makes mistakes, and there may have been a rut on the ice or something that he slipped on, it doesn't negate the fact that he is a brilliant skater, nor that Yuzuru is a brilliant skater, both in their own very different rights. But yeah, no, definitely somewhat disappointing, but if you can still garner a world silver medal by 25 some odd points on an off day, you're fine, Yuzuru. And he'll have the whole summer, he'll have the whole off season. And you know, I agree with you, Bronwyn. This is definitely my favorite long program of his, and I hope he can keep churning out material like that, because it really, really, it's gorgeous. And it's the most genuine I think he's performed. Yeah, I definitely love his long program this season. Let's move on to the, I would say, the surprise bronze medalist, especially after the short program, Boyang Jin of China. His free skate was not the most impressive, technically, but his base value is just so ridiculous that he still scored above 100. And it makes you think if he was totally clean and perfect, like we've seen him almost be this season, where he would end up in relation to both Kolyada, the fourth place finisher, and even Yuzuru, the silver medalist we just talked about. Performance-wise, though, he still skates like a junior to me, I have to say. I don't know if his material is very appropriate for what he has right now, specifically the short program, more so than the long. Because I feel like the short is supposed to, I feel like he's not there yet in terms of tapping into that emotional and suave kind of depth and feeling. I just feel like he doesn't have that yet. Not to say he can't have that and won't have that, but I just don't think he was ready for material like that yet. And the short program, in terms of choreography and its mood, kind of, it's a little bit uncomfortable because you can see how he's not really comfortable with it. And I'm happy that through this season, the judges haven't awarded him program component scores just because he has the quad lutz and is such a brilliant technician. But good on him for holding it together and pulling up and taking advantage of, honestly, mistakes like Patrick made to pull up and take that bronze medal, which, I mean, you can't fault him for that. What did you guys think of Boyang here?
Yeah, I agree with what you said. I've actually seen people complain about his program component scores in the long program, but he actually scored the lowest PCS mm-hmm. of the entire top 10, mm-hmm. not just even the top 5. I know that his PCS seemed high and compared to that, but scoring has skewed high in all disciplines, especially at these worlds. And in comparison to everyone else, his PCS are actually pretty solid.
The judges see the difference.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I don't know. I'm really impressed with him. I'm not going to lie. He might not be, you know, the most artistic skater, and obviously there are skaters who are farther ahead of him in almost all the components, but he is just such a brilliant technician. His quad lutz not only gets, like, it's not even, like, muscled out. It is just mm-hmm. pure jumping. The technique is great. The air position is really, really good, too. Mm-hmm. I'm really impressed with him, and I do think he has the potential with the right programs. I believe these are the same programs he had last season, mm-hmm. so I'm assuming next year he'll get new programs, and we will be able, I hope that they will give him something that will allow him to grow. I don't know if he'll ever be, you know, the most artistic of skaters, and his basics really need a lot of work, but I just think there's a lot of potential there that is untapped, and I really hope that with the right choreographer, the right music, the right packaging, we'll actually be able to see that, and because I think he's ready for something, and like, I don't think he's there with the short program, but I think his long program is a bit too juniorish for him. I think he's ready for something a little bit more mature.
I agree with you guys about his short program. I think it's a little bit overwhelming, a little too sophisticated for where he is currently in terms of artistry. But I applaud that he's doing something almost out of his comfort zone, because I feel like that's how you grow as a skater. And even though I don't find it to be 100% successful, you know, as a short program, I think that, you know, in the future we could definitely see him go in different directions with the music that he chooses, the type of characters, the interpretation. And, you know, at the beginning of the season, I think that I was a bit quick to dismiss him as just a jumping bean coming out of the junior ranks. But I think that he's more than that, even at this point in his career. You know, obviously there's a lot he could work on. I think if you look closely at his basic skating, especially in his footwork, despite the fact that he's such a powerful jumper, some of his steps can be very small, and there's a sort of frantic quality to his footwork sometimes, just because he's trying to get those edges and turns out, but he doesn't necessarily have the power to match the speed. And so little things like that, that could obviously be improved, but I see a lot of potential for him. I think that his jumps, you know, aren't going anywhere. His artistry is only going to improve. So I'm excited to see really what the future holds for him.
Yeah, a lot of these skaters, even in the top 10, he was up against an experienced field. I guess with the exception of Shoma, like these men have been around for at least 3 or 4 seasons in the senior ranks. And they, through experience, they've almost gained that artistic edge, even if they're not the most innate artists to begin with. Because, like, I can think of, like, Javier in Vancouver. He had that, like, Pirates of the Caribbean, and I would hardly call it an artistic masterpiece. And I wouldn't say he was a jumper to start out, primarily. And look where he is now. Look how far he's come in just 1.5 Olympiads. I hope the judges don't see this bronze medal as a mistake and do something like they did to the Shibs in 2011, because Boyang has potential artistically. And I don't want the judges to beat him down just because of that. Because though he does have room to grow, there is a starting place and there is potential there. Let's move on to the fourth place. I was about to say the fourth place medalist, the potato
medalist.
We're not
at U.S. Nationals, Will.
I know. Mikhail Kolyada of Russia, really doing well for himself here at these World Championships. Affectionately named the Pineapple King by my two co-hosts. His technique is unbelievable, just to start out. His knees are ridiculous. You can break that triple axel down in slow-mo. It is textbook technique. That being said, he does tend to telegraph, I noticed. He takes like a half a load of the rink. He doesn't have the best transitions, but just, I'm so impressed with his jumps and his performance, too. You know, his programs aren't for everyone. They're very quirky and they're very unique, I'll say. But I love how committed he is to the character of both of his programs and how he just doesn't care what people say or think about his programs, and he just does it and he does his material to the best of his ability, and I love that. And you can really see how much he enjoys skating, and I think he's... again, has so much potential for the future. What did you guys make of Kolyada and his performances here, and where do you think he'll be in the future?
So I feel like we have to explain the Pineapple King nickname, because you just sort of brought it up.
Yeah.
So we started calling him Pineapple King because we noticed his last name is Kolyada, and it looks like Kolada. So, like, we thought of Pina Coladas, and, you know, Pina Kolyada. And it just sort of went from there, and we started calling him the Pineapple King. I think you guys threw him a pineapple at Worlds.
We did.
I'm very proud of you, because I couldn't be there, although I know Will and Kathy had a really good time. I couldn't be there, because I'm far from Boston.
Hashtag college.
And also college. Look, there was a lot of factors keeping me from Boston this year, but that's okay. I watched from home. But anyway, back to what we were talking about. His Kalyata's technique, like you said, Will, it's just so good. I've never seen a triple Lutz look as easy as he makes it. And you know he's going to nail it every single time. Honestly, I've seen multiple people say this, and it looks like he could actually fit another rotation in there. So it would be interesting. I don't know, if as long as he can do it consistently, because that's what he's going to need going forward, is consistently good performances. I think that's something, because I know he wants to add another quad. I don't know, we'll have to see with him, because he's just such an exciting prospect. He's a lot different, and I think between him and Adi Anpikiev, the Russian men are just, they've become so interesting to me, you know? And I like his programs, too. I really like the short program because it's fun, but it's also not, like, it's unique and fun at the same time. It's, like, kind of a comedic tango, almost. Like a clown tango. I don't really know how to describe it. But, yeah, no, definitely. I've become a huge fan of his this season, and I can't wait to see where he goes from here, especially because he needed to skate well after Kovtun's really disappointing performance. Russia really needed him to put out a good performance.
Yeah, so this season was kind of a breakout season for Kalyata. He sort of came out of nowhere last fall, I think, to medal at the Ice Challenge, I believe, was one of his senior Bs. And he won silver at Russian Nationals, which is obviously a really great placement for someone who has virtually been unknown until this point. And I think what's so special about his programs is, like you guys mentioned, that sort of that personality, that sort of odd brand of humor that I think is very similar to Kovtun's, only in Kalyata's case, it's very, he has definitely the technique and the jumps to back it up, whereas Kovtun is such a wild card that, you know, he could either be, you know, top five in the world, or like he placed here, I believe it was 18th. So it's really hard to tell with Kovtun, whereas I feel like Kalyata has the potential to be more consistent. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I see him as being sort of a more stable force in Russian men's skating going forward. Not to discount Kovtun's talent or abilities. Another thing is, Will was talking about this earlier, but his jump technique is really great, and his posture and form just in general. When you watch him skate, his back is always straight, you know, his landings coming out of jumps. His extension, knee bend, and everything is really great, and so those are the sort of finishing touches that can make a skater really pop and stand out among a field that's as deep as the one we saw here at Worlds. So moving on to the fifth place finisher, Patrick Chan from Canada. I think a bit of a disappointment considering that he's a three-time world champion, but this was his comeback season, and as we know, comebacks can be very difficult. All in all, not a bad showing at Worlds, although he was 8th place in the free skate, which must be a disappointment for him. And we saw him make mistakes again, like Yuzuru, that were sort of uncharacteristic, because his free skate is usually what pulls him up if he has a rough short program, or at least it has been this season. What did you guys think of Patrick's performance?
Yeah, I definitely agree with you. Probably not the performance he was looking for, especially after his brilliant, brilliant long program at Four Continents. His short program was decent, not the best, but it's also been better than the short programs he's had this season. It kept him in the game, and that was what's important, because that's what he really was struggling with this season. He was always behind after the short program and having to make back up with the long program. We kind of saw the opposite, and it's not like he's ever been that consistent, but comebacks are going to be even harder on you, and I expect him to look a little bit better next season. I don't know if he'll put out brilliant performances as much as someone like Yuzuru did this season, but I also think that we will see him looking a lot better next season, and I think he'll be in better shape. I think if he had to come back, I think taking a year off for him, it was good taking a year off and then coming back next season, and because I feel like he's going to be pacing himself better for the Olympics.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it was definitely good coaching this season, even just within himself, like self-coaching, to come back with a program that is like in his wheelhouse. Like his long program is very classic Patrick Chan, and I'm happy that he could almost use that as a platform to like rest back on, so that he could focus on the jumps to be competitive. Which I think was a really smart move this season. And, he's top five in the world. I mean, and he's one of the most beautiful skaters, I think, ever. His run of edge is unbelievable. I mean, it's... When he's on, and when the when everything clicks, he's floating. He's floating above the ice. It's unbelievable. And it was disappointing. And it also is, though... like you mentioned before, Kathy, with Hanyu, he and Chan are not infallible, because they did let the performance suffer a little bit when they had issues with the jumps, but I think this was I would call this a successful comeback season for Patrick. I wouldn't say it was, not probably exactly what he was hoping for, especially after being third after the short, but I'm happy that he has, is seeing through a clear lens and is seeing his career, I think, holistically, and seeing where this season fits in. I think he knows, though it may not be great to be fifth in the world right now, it's not a disaster, and it's still good. And he can do something that'll make him stand out and do something drastic, I think, over the off season that'll help him towards next season and towards Pyeongchang and those Olympic Games. What did you think of him, Kathy?
Yeah, I agree with you. He's definitely in this for the long run, especially at his age. You know, I'm sure he knows to how to put things into perspective. And, you know, one subpar competition is not obviously going to define his career or even his season. And so I think that moving towards his goal of the 2018 Olympics, this is still a step in the right direction, by all means. I think that he just has to work on not only solidifying what he already has and does so well, which is his skating skills, just the pure artistry that he can create. And that's always been the backbone of his skating, I think. Not only can he hold on to that and even improve on it, possibly, he's working on getting, I believe, a quad salchow to stay competitive with the top of the field. And so he's becoming that whole package, even more of a whole package skater than he already is. And so I think that he's definitely, he's focused and he has his, he knows what he needs to do. And I think that's really important. That's a really important mindset to have going forward.
No, definitely. I completely agree. It's just like, and kind of compared to Yuzuru, it's kind of similar. It's hard to compare it to the magic that was his four continents long program. You were kind of expecting something like that. And it's hard because you know he's not that consistent, but when someone skates so good,
you just want that.
You just want that all the time because his... Honestly, like, that was a legendary performance, in my opinion. It's a great, amazing vehicle for him. It works so well for him. So I'm excited to see him come back stronger next season.
Definitely, definitely. Before we talk about the American man. The American man as a whole. I want to talk about Shoma quickly. You know, again, it's sort of the same deal. Like, he his with Patrick and with Yuzu, his expectations of himself are so high that, like, we were talking about this before we went on air, but to be seventh at your first senior world is so good. It's such a good starting place, and it's so, like, for the rest of his career and his senior career, I mean. And I loved both of his programs this year. I was heartbroken to see how distraught he was with his skate after the free skate. That was really upsetting. And you just want him to go home and regroup and rest and after a performance like that and after a moment like that and just and then after that just get back to work and see what he can do. But back to his performances. Here, I love his short program this year. I thought it's so fun, and it's still he was able to really harp upon what he does best, which is again those skating skills and just the ease and the run of edge. And I think his choreography in both programs is brilliant at showcasing exactly that. And he, too, has been really consistent this season. He has been seemingly unfazed by the pressure. I'm not quite sure if pressure was the deal with this, not even unfortunate. His free skate was fine. It just knocked him down a few runs in the placement. But it could have been a deal with pressure, though, because he was in fourth and was hoping possibly for a medal. But, you know, I'm excited to see where he goes because this, by any stretch of the imagination, is not a disaster. So, and I just love him so much, and I can't wait to see where he goes. What do you guys think of him?
I completely agree. I actually think, because, like, while he seemed more unfazed at the beginning of the season, mm-hmm. and which culminated in a Grand Prix final medal, which was huge, and he skated so well. And then, like, I feel like the pressure might have gotten to him a bit more because we saw he didn't make the podium at Four Continents. And it's just he wasn't as good as we saw earlier in the season. And it might be something that he's just – it's still an adjustment to make it from the junior level to the senior level. And I think there's just nowhere to go but up for him. This isn't even a bad result. I know he's disappointed. And I know that's not the one he was looking for, especially because he was in fourth and close to a medal. It could have medaled if he had skated better. But I just think that there is just so much potential there. And there's just so much that I think he's going to have a really long career. And I think we are just going to be really lucky to watch his career and watch him grow like this, because I think he is such a special skater. And I am so excited to see where he goes from here. And I can't wait to see his new programs next season if he gets new programs. I'm, like, sitting here, I'm like, what is he going to do? I can't wait.
Yeah, Shoma is one of those skaters who is just really intense. And like you guys mentioned, I'm sure he can be hard on himself, as we saw after the free skate. I mean, he was devastated, and I just really felt for him because the pressure he puts on himself must be akin to, if not more than, the pressure he feels from other people. But I feel like he's one of those skaters who, you know, even seventh at the World Championships is not a disaster by any means. And even then, it's a bit of a fluke for him because we've seen him do so much better over and over. So I don't think that consistency is necessarily an issue with him. Of course, he could use more experience, I think, on the senior level. I had almost forgotten that this was his first full senior season because it feels like he's been in seniors forever, just the level of maturity and sophistication that he presents out there on the ice is so convincing that you almost forget his age and the fact that this is his senior world debut. But yeah, other than that, I'm really excited to see the programs that he puts out next season. He reminds me almost of a young Dennis Ten in the just the intensity that he has, the sort of subdued and quiet artistry. It's not flamboyant or in your face. It's not, even though his choice of music for his short program is really just snappy and unique and interesting, and it makes you want to get up and dance, you know, even then he's presenting sort of a, I don't know how you would describe it, but he's presenting a more soulful side of the music, mm-hmm. if there even is one. But so I think that he's really special in that way, in that he brings something to the table that not many other skaters do, even at his young age. So I'm really excited to see how his career takes off in the future.
Definitely. I think you could also compare him. I see a lot of Daisuke Takahashi in him, too. I feel like the word is almost like they're both almost nonchalant about the way they just stroke and skate around the ice. Not to say they look apathetic when they're on the ice, but just their ease and their run of edge and just the way they're able to pick up speed in just a few simple strokes, it's a testament to how good both Daisuke and Shoma's technique is. And I can't wait to see what he puts out next season, because his style is just so, so wonderful and so watchable and just so aesthetically pleasing. Let's move on to the American men, who all three of them had phenomenal showings. I think even definitely exceeded a lot of people's expectations of how they would do here at Worlds. 6th, 8th, and 10th were how Adam, Max, and Grant Hochstein finished respectively. And it was just fantastic to see. Let's start with Grant. He had a bit of a disappointing short program. He had that fall on the quad. But Grant, he's so beautiful. He's such a stunning skater. He is, he is sort of like Shoma, not in terms of the way they look and their aesthetics. I think their physiques are very different, and how they look on the ice physically is very different. But they're similar in the way they present themselves. I think, again, very subdued, but still they have such a strong connection to their music and how it relates to their movement and what they do on the ice. I think it's really, really special. I think Grant is super gifted, and oh, that free skate was such a moment. Definitely one of my favorite moments of this World Championships, because the crowd was just so behind him, and he used that to his advantage. And he just kept going and going, and he landed that quad, and then he landed the next thing, and he landed the next thing, and it was, and the performance was just brilliant. I loved him before, but I really did truly fall in love with him and his skating through this World Championships. What did you guys think of Grant?
Yeah, no, I completely agree with you. I love the short program a lot. It's mm-hmm. I've talked about it so much. Well, you know how much I love Inari.
Yeah.
He's my favorite composer, so
yeah.
I will support anyone using his music, but the way Grant did it was special, and it was kind of disappointing to see him place so low in the short program, but obviously he made up for it with the freescape, because holy crap, that was the first real moment of the World Championships, I'd say. That was, like, everyone was behind him. And I love, one of my favorite things about skating, and this is why I watch skating, are those moments when they hit, a skater hits their program at the biggest competition of their life, and the crowd is just behind them every step of the way. Like, when the crowd gets so loud that you can't really hear the music, that's the best thing ever. oh my god, I was a huge fan of Grant. Like, this has also been a breakout season for him, and I'm definitely a big fan now. I loved his skating before, but it was just, it's hard to put into words just how good it was. It was just so special, and I just think, honestly, I can't wait to see more from him. I think everything just came together. It was the best quad he's ever landed. I'm getting speechless. I don't know what to say. It was one of my favorite moments of Worlds by far. Kathy, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, Grant is one of those skaters who just really creates, I think, an atmosphere with his program. It's not just jumps on the ice. It's about the feel and the mood of the program, and I think that his music selection definitely helps with that. Such dramatic, vocal music from a musical as well known as Les Mis certainly helped the crowd sort of relate to him and sort of get behind him, but that's not to say that his personal ability isn't just as impressive. I mean, he's certainly a very compelling skater in a lot of ways. He has the artistry, but he also has very solid jumps, And to be honest, I was very impressed with his placement here because I did not expect him to break top 10, especially because he was an alternate for Worlds, and maybe we like people weren't expecting him to do as well as Nathan Chen would have done. Obviously, we can't speculate on that because Nathan had to withdraw. But just seizing the moment in every way, I think, is what made this so special him for him. It was his first World Championships in his home country, and to be able to deliver a free skate like that and have the crowd leap to its feet, in the first couple of groups, I think is really unique and a really special moment.
Yeah, he definitely, I don't know, I like can't stress enough how much he sees the moment, because I don't know how many other world championship teams he's gonna make, because Nathan may be back and better than ever next season, and there are just a lot of stars that aligned for Grant to make four continents and the world championship team this season. So I'm just so happy that, and the fact that it's in Boston, home country, again, another great coincidence for him. But I'm so happy that he was able to perform the way he did. I mean, it was just fantastic.
No, I completely agree. Real quick, before we move on, I just want to say, he also got engaged right after Worlds, real quick, to Caroline Jang, and I just want to say I'm really happy for the both of them, and I want to say congrats to them. So if they ever somehow end up watching Lutz and Glory, but it was such, I was just like, he must be having the week of his life
Oh my gosh.
because he was like first Worlds, and then like a couple of days later, he's like, we're engaged, and I was like, that's so cute.
And also we have word of Caroline possibly competing next season, which is super exciting, and I loved her when she was competing, so hopefully she'll be good. Let's move on to the second best American here, Max Aaron. Also had a really, really solid competition. Especially that free program. He did the same type thing that Grant did. He used the energy and just the electricity in the building to the best of to his advantage. And I thought, Max is not my favorite skater to watch. And his free skate, even though it was really, really clean, there was a marked difference between his performance and Adam's performance, and even Grant's performance, I would say. He's not a bad skater at all. He has worked so hard on his edges and his steps and making everything as deep and as crisp as he possibly can. But I still get the sense that he's focusing more on the jumps than he is on the performance. And that's something that I can't fault him for, because as a hockey player transitioning into figure skating, I feel like hockey players would initially focus on the athleticism and the athletic side of the sport before the art. And I don't know. I hope he can make that transition soon and finally see this other dimension to skating. Not to say he's a completely inartistic skater, because he's not, but it's just not up to the caliber of someone like Adam or even Grant. So I hope that in the coming seasons he'll be able to maintain his technical prowess, but still just maybe take more dance classes or do something that'll help him get in touch with his music and musicality and his artistic side. Because again, he has everything he needs. I'm happy he was able to showcase everything he has here in Boston. What did you guys think of Max, this world?
Yeah, I actually, when you watch his exhibition from Boston, he's having so much fun. And I was like, I was just totally digging it. I thought he put so much more, it was just like a huge difference from his competition skating. And obviously I'm not saying like, you know, it's always going to be all fun all the time in competition, but I think he needs something like that. I'm not saying, because he skated to ACDC, I think, and I'm not saying he needs to, like, skate to rock and roll, you know, do whatever he wants, but I'm just saying he needs to find something like that that allows him to have fun on the ice and, like, maybe play with the audience a little more, like, interact with the audience more.
It'll force himself to shift his focus to the performance.
Yeah, no, I agree. I agree, because the jumps this season are actually, like, a million times more consistent than they were last season. It's actually really impressive how far he's come since last season, where it was kind of a disappointment for him, but he, like, you could tell he really got back in the gear, he got focused. Honestly, when you look at his programs, because he debuted on that World Team Trophy last year, you can tell that there is stuff taken out of the choreography, stuff in the choreography that changed, because I was really impressed at World Team Trophy, and then we got to the season, I'm like, oh, where did it all go? It was really good. Like, I was kind of disappointed. I thought he was making a lot of progress, and then all of a sudden, the long program was just really empty, and there was just, the choreography didn't make sense anymore, and I was kind of really disappointed. So I really hope Max can find programs that allow him to have fun, and, like, he doesn't even need to be artistic, like, skate the Black Swan beautifully, or, you know, he doesn't need to be like that. I just want him to enjoy himself on the ice, you know? Do something that just allows him to, like, cut loose a little bit.
Yeah, I think the smart thing for Max in future seasons might just be picking music that he genuinely connects with and enjoys skating to. I think that in some ways, it could be a disservice giving him these classical pieces of music, these war horses that so many great skaters before him have skated to, because the expectation is always there. The pressure of just living up to these iconic programs. And I think it might be wise to sort of step back and focus on maybe pick a piece of music that he would personally listen to in his free time, or something that he just has a genuine interest in. Not to say that he, you know, he can't connect to classical music, but it's a lot more difficult to not let the music overwhelm you when you're just in the early stages, I think, of becoming an artist. And but yeah, like you guys said, his jumps have looked so much more consistent than they have been in past seasons. Overall, this was a great season for him in terms of what he was able to put out technically. I think that his quads are only getting stronger by the day, and they were great to begin with, so that's really telling. And I think that I sort of see the trajectory of his career as maybe paralleling Gracie Gold in ladies figure skating, because we saw with Gracie in earlier seasons that she was skating to music that she really wasn't feeling, but as soon as she found these pieces that she could connect to and that she could perform convincingly, I think she sort of found her groove, and we've been seeing that. So if Max could do the same thing, I think that that would just do wonders for his career.
Certainly. Yeah, no, definitely, I agree. Let's move on to the final American, whom we haven't discussed yet, Adam Rippon, the U.S. champ. He was magical. I mean, like, he was nothing short of magical, especially in the free programming. He was brilliant. His hobbies and Grant's free skates, I think, were my three moments. And Yuzuru's short program, I think, were my four moments of the men's event here at Worlds. He, I think, honestly, more than most, if not all, the other men in this field, Adam is able to project upwards. He is so concerned with the audience first and just making the audience, like, wishing, like, having the audience be happy that they got their money's worth for their tickets, because I know the tickets were not the cheapest things in the world, but he is so lyrical and so musical, but at the same time, he is such an outward, flamboyant performer. And it's so brilliant to see, and I'm so happy he was, I feel like his entire career, he's been lowballed, in terms of marks, especially in program components. But I think that judges are finally starting to see what a gift and what a talent he is, to our sport. His free program is just brilliant. I didn't love it initially, but it's come along so nicely, and I'm so happy. A top six finish, putting out two of the best performances of your season. I cannot wait to see where he goes next season and where he'll be in relation to the top men in the world in the coming years. What did you guys make of Adam this world?
Yeah, Adam is definitely a fan favorite skater, and honestly, that's such a deserved title for him because he performs so much. The first time, and it's actually interesting because the first time I ever saw Adam skate live was 2013 Skate America, and he did his Afternoon of a Fawn long program. I think that's the name of the music, but you know which one, the Fawn long program. And it's just that was a very lyrical program, very balletic. And then 2 years later, he's got something that's completely different. It's all Beatles. It feels like, it honestly felt like a concert, and that's what I've been comparing it to all season. But it's like, this performance especially, he was like pointing at the audience. He was like, you know, he was basically flirting with the audience a little bit, but like in a good way, you know? And the short program, even that, because this season he hasn't really done, like he's done solid short programs, but he never did a fully clean one until Worlds, and this just, it was his weekend, honestly. I just had this good vibe about him all weekend, reading practice reports, seeing him through people periscoping from the arena, just seeing the jumps, and I'm like, oh my god, he is so ready. Like, you could tell that he was going to do well. I had no doubt in him. The only thing I was worried about was the quad lots, and it's still not great. He got an under rotation, which is a lot better than we've been seeing, and he stood up on it.
Mm-hmm.
But I would love to see him to get the quad lots more consistent or find another more consistent quad so that way he can actually start challenging for like medals. Because I think he's ready. Now that he's been with Raph for a while, now that like the triple axel is like not even a concern for him
not
anymore.
Even a question,
yeah. I just think that this was like the culmination of everything coming together for Adam, and I think there's no ceiling on how high he can go as long as he keeps this up, because it was just so magical, as you put it.
It's funny because if you had told me even two years ago, maybe after 2014 Nationals, that Adam was going to play sixth at the World Championships, I flat out would not have believed you. I mean, the progress that he's made in the past two seasons alone is so immense, and it's so just inspirational, I think is the only way to put it, because, you know, I think people were ready to count him out. You know, I was, I have to admit, I was ready to count him out, but he just came back so strong last season, and especially this season, and he continues to improve day after day, and like you said, Will, he just has this superb sort of presence on the ice, and during his free skate, he just had the crowd in the palm of his hand. There was no question that there was no question of what a great showman he can be, and what the kind of a connection that he can establish with his music. And we've seen him skate to such a great range of pieces. Mm-hmm. You know, he can do Carmen, he can do the Beatles, he can do basically anything he wants to at this point, because he has the experience and the maturity to pull off such a great variety of programs, and I think that's what's so great about him, and it gives him a bit of an advantage over other competitors who maybe aren't as seasoned or aren't as comfortable with the different genres of music. And you know, we often compare Adam to Ashley because they're training mates, best friends, and it's so interesting how their careers have sort of also developed side by side, because both of them had great junior careers, and then sort of towards the early half of their senior careers, it was you know, not the greatest, but they're getting back up there, you know. Mm-hmm. We're seeing almost a renaissance in their careers, and I think that Adam can only go up from here because his everything just seems to be coming together for him, you know, his coaching situation, his jumps. That was one of his more solid quad lutzes that he's landed in competition. And so everything is just, all these factors, I think, are adding up to help him, you know, improve and become even better in future seasons.
Yeah, I like what you said about his versatility. I think it shows how comfortable he is, like, with himself, and how well he knows himself in terms of his style on the ice. And he's such a chameleon. Like, he can skate to things like Carmen and Afternoon of a Fawn and his brilliant free skate last year, and then he can completely switch gears 180 degrees and go Queen and Beatles medley. And he makes it his own, and he makes it authentic, and he makes it accessible. And that's just what I love so much about Adam, and I think that's what a lot of fans love also about Adam. Before we move on to dance, I just want to give a brief shout-out to Dennis Ten, who placed a respectable 11th place here. He has had a really rough season, and those injuries have just been unrelenting to him. And I wish him all the best, and I hope he gets tons of rest and comes back round to go next season. Okay, so with that, let's move on to the dance competition. The gold medalists defended their title from last year in Shanghai, Gabriela Papadakis and Guillaume Cizeron of France. We talked a lot about the scoring and the obvious world record breaking. Before we get into that, though, I have to appreciate them as a team and just their steep, steep trajectory in the sport. There's the adage, the 13th at Worlds in 2014, and suddenly they're the champions the next year. But they're so beautiful. They're both so beautiful. And you can still see a difference in how he, I think, is one of the best dancers I've ever seen individually. And you can still see how Gabriela is still sort of trying to catch up to him, specifically in just, I'd say, the depth of edge, and also the twizzles. She sometimes isn't bang on the money on the twizzles, but I'll be interested to see what they put out next year. They weren't on the Grand Prix circuit this year, so they were kind of like, but they are like a known quantity in the sport, and people were like, watch out for them once they get to French Nationals. And they went to French Nationals, they were magical. They went to Europeans, they were magical. And they came to Boston, and they were magical yet again. So now, though, I want to shift gears to the scoring. I'm going to have to disagree with how they not just broke, but 2 points, a two-point defeat over Marilyn Charlie's old record. In the free dance, that's a lot. That's a lot in ice dance, especially in ice dance. And I thought it was brilliant. I saw their free skate. I mean, I didn't see it live, obviously, but I rewatched it, and they have this X factor. They have this quality to them that is just inexplicable, but it's so captivating. Their movement, but I don't know. I feel like giving them, they still have things to work on. They're not perfect. No one skater at this entire World Championships is or will ever be perfect. And the judges gave them a nod and said, this is near perfect. And it was phenomenal, don't get me wrong, but I'm a little concerned with the message the judges are sending them, and I don't think it means they'll be lackadaisical in their training for seasons to come, but I feel like it tells them that they don't still have things to work on, and they do. Everyone does. Mm-hmm. In the sex dance field. And in all four disciplines. What did you guys think of Gabriella and Guillaume here?
I agree with you 100%. I was actually not really happy about it at all. I mean, this is also coming from a really big self-professed Meryl and Charlie fan, but they just don't compare to either Meryl or Charlie or Tessa and Scott in their prime. And you can't really compare competitions, but I just don't know. I just struggle with them breaking the world record because there is so much they can improve on still. And to say, because obviously 120 is the highest score you can get in ice dance for a free dance. To say that they are 2 points less than perfection, I really struggle to agree with that just because, like, there's still a noticeable weakness in between their strengths. You can tell she's not as good as he is. They are both really, really good, but I'd like to see them work on getting closer to each other in ability because it's still pretty noticeable. And I just think that it's scoring has just gotten a bit out of control in general.
That's one thing I want to mention about this championships. I feel like once the judges gave Luca and Anna, like, 112, I think,
mm-hmm.
they were like, oh, that's a lot of points. Now we have to give this next group also a lot of points. And I think the judges and the audience, I feel like everyone just caught up in the moment, and that tends to happen at big mm-hmm. championships like this. But I feel like, realistically, I feel like the top six or seven teams could have scored 5 points less, honestly, in the free dance. And then those, I think, would have and should have been the justified scores. Because, I don't know, I think it was just the general propensity of the night. It was just, like, building and building and building and intensity, and everything was, the scores were going up, and everything was just rising. And the scores held suit to that. I'm sorry to cut you off, Bronwyn, but...
No, it's okay. That's totally fine.
That's just like part of the reason that the world record was broken and it should not have been. But.
Absolutely. I would not be surprised if IJS gets some sort of changes made to it because of this, just because of this world in general. Scoring was a bit ridiculous in general. And even over the season, I think. It's skewed so high for all disciplines that I would be pretty surprised if some sort of change didn't happen in this off season because now you gotta try to top that. And are you just gonna start giving 120s to everyone? That's an exaggeration, but where do you go from here? And I don't know if you really can go somewhere from there now that it's almost that high. Because it took, Meryl and Charlie, like, set that record at the Olympics, and that stood for 2 years. So you'd have to think they'd probably go higher for the next one. I mean, I don't know, because I am not an ice dance expert, unfortunately. I'm working on it, but I am not one. So I don't know if I can really say, but it felt way too high for me.
While we're on the subject of scoring, I think that what really concerns me is the number of 10s that Papadakis and Cizeron received in their program component score in the free dance. And then, Bronwyn, you mentioned this, that there's a ceiling in ice dance scoring, definitely. And the closer you get to that ceiling, the more it becomes, it becomes a question of, who can get the closest to it? And it sort of, it almost defeats the purpose of the categories like program components because the point is that it's so hard, if not impossible, to get a perfect 10. Mm-hmm. And now you're giving them out freely, and I just think that is a bit questionable, to say the least. And two more things. One, another issue I have with the free dance is that if you look at their twizzle sequence, Even though there weren't any egregious errors. If you look at the first set of Twizzles, Gabriella does make, does have a noticeable bobble.
In the short
animal.
In
the way her free leg is moving up and down. And she sort of, she slips out of the edge a little bit, and she's skidding. And it's not, like I said, it's not totally obvious at first glance.
But it shouldn't
I went back
get a plus
and
three.
I slow-mo.
But it shouldn't get a plus three grade of execution.
Right, exactly. For those GOEs, plus two and three across the board, that it doesn't match up with what they actually produce. Mm-hmm. And so it makes you question the validity of scoring to be a bit extreme. And you just think, you know, where you guys pose this question, but where do you go from here? You know, in the future, how does this affect future dance teams? Be it teams who are already competing or teams who are moving up from juniors or people who decide to pursue ice dance in the future and see it as a discipline that is where the scoring is maybe not as reliable as in the other disciplines. And one last thing about Papa Doc's and Cizeron, they're short dance. I don't think we've talked about it yet this season, but their short dance, the music is not a waltz piece, but they superimpose this beat on top of it to make it into a waltz. And I just, it's not wrong. There's nothing, you know, wrong with it, but it just doesn't feel organic to me. And for the level that you are at and the scores that you're getting, I have to question that use of music. And I know I'm being super critical about them. I think they're supremely talented. I don't disagree with them defending their title by any means. But it's just, you know, the expectations that come with being world champion, you have to hold them to a certain standard. And you have to wonder at the decisions behind these music choices, you know, and especially with a piece of music that's also being used by another prominent skater. The music that in their short dance is also in Evgenia Medvedeva's free skate. I'm sorry. So the fact that it's a piece that everybody is hearing over and over, the fact that you are not using it in its original form and you're making it into a waltz, you know, that just it stands out and not necessarily in a positive way.
I will say, in their defense, they didn't have as much time to prepare because of her concussion in the off season, and they missed the Grand Prix circuit. I will say, in their defense, they didn't have as much time to prepare. So when they got sort of that feedback from the European judges that, oh, your music isn't really a waltz, and you don't have that much time, and you didn't have that much time to begin with, I can understand kind of like, you know, trying to make these sort of not the best edits, but like trying to fix it, remedy it the best that you can. I mean, obviously that doesn't really excuse the scoring, but I mean, we've seen worse, and like there are skaters who like Chalk and Bates who changed their short dance three times. We saw Weaver and Poche change their short dance. So I can understand it not really like wanting to completely redo it that late in the season when they didn't have that much time to prepare in the beginning with, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, that's definitely something to keep in mind. But I still think that Piper and Paul, they took a risk, and it didn't initially pay off, I don't think, but they made those music changes, and their short dance was fantastic here in Boston, in my opinion. And you can still be creative. Like, you can still think outside the box for these waltzes and for the short dance, which do have a certain set of parameters. But it still has to be, I feel like it still should be an organic waltz. But again, they didn't have as much time, so, you know. But I do, one thing I want to note before we move on to the Shibutanis is, at 2004 World Championships, the judges, I remember, in the ladies' short program, they were handing sixes out like candy. And the Eurosport commentators made a note of that. But that's because they knew a change was coming in from 6.0 to IJS. So they almost felt like they had to get the sixes out where they felt skaters deserved them. And I hope that's the case with this. I hope this means a change is coming to the JS system. There are some addendum of strictures that'll hopefully prevent this from happening again. And with that, let's move on to the Shibutanis, the U.S. champions, and now we can say the multi-time world medalist, the 2016 world silver medalist. I am so, so proud of them. They have had an unbelievable season. I just can't stress enough how much of a vehicle this free dance was for them. I really think it just means everything to their success this season, but also to their success in the coming seasons. I think it gave them the confidence in their abilities to be able to, now that I feel like they can explore and do so much more, and they know they can do that now, that they have this season in their back pocket and a world silver medal in their back pocket. I'm just so happy for them. This is such a well-deserved silver medal. What did you guys think of this year's time?
I completely agree with you. We've been talking, everyone in the skating community has been talking about their free dance, how magical it is, how well it works for them. And I think that they're an example of not only perseverance, because it took them 5 years after being on the world podium to get back on the world podium, but also just being, taking risks and trying new things. We'll see that with other skaters later on, but they're one of them because they went with, because they did, last season, they had their exhibition to Coldplay's O, and it was choreographed by Peter Chernyshev. And so, because it was so well-received, instead of going through Marina Zueva, who coached them very well, like, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying, oh, she was nothing, but they went to a different choreographer, and it just paid off in dividends for them. It created a magical program that produced many, many beautiful moments throughout the season, and like you said, well, I'm just really proud of them, and I just think that there's such a marked improvement from even last season to this season in the way they skate. Everything just has come together, and it's kind of like a lot of the American skaters, even, everything is just coming together for them, mm-hmm. and I am very impressed, and I can't wait to see what they come up with next, because it might be hard to top, but I also think they're ready.
Yeah, and I keep saying this about skaters, but I think that this season is definitely a launching pad of sorts for the Shibutani's' career. I think that, you know, for so long we watched them sort of at being sort of stalled in their career because it didn't appear on the surface that they were making a lot of progress, and they kept being just under the surface of breaking out. And now that they've done it, you know, it's such a triumphant moment for them, and it's so gratifying as fans to see their hard work pay off finally. And I think that the fact that they've won the U.S. championships, they've won four continents, and they've gotten silver at Worlds in a row is such great momentum for them going into next season. And I think that the fact that they've returned to the world podium should be a sign to them that they're doing things right, and that they can continue to push themselves even further. And as wonderful as both of their programs are, especially the free dance, you know, it's so hard to nitpick and find things that they could improve on, but they're still there, you know. Just the overall, I think, fluidity and power of their skating, I think, could be improved. Obviously, it's not a mistake that you can point to explicitly, but I think it's the overall quality and the just energy generated by their program. And this was another really great moment in Boston, you know, for the crowd to be fully supporting them. And we know that Maya and Alex, especially Alex, have close ties to Boston because mm-hmm. they're just they just love the city so much, and the city loves them back. And so that was a really great thing to be able to witness. But yeah, it's I see them going even greater length. I see them going to even greater heights in the future, and I see them taking on even more music that people have maybe counted out for them because they are a sibling duo, and I see them pushing the boundaries of what it means to skate as brother and sister, but not only that, you know, far less superficially, I see them being a really driving force behind USI stance and international ice stance.
Definitely, certainly, and I hope that Madison Chalk and Evan Bates are seeing this. The World Bronze Medalists, congrats to them, but I really hope they're seeing this surge of Maya and Alex, because I think it's going to light a fire under their butts, because they came into this season sort of, I think, through a lot of eyes, especially, you know, the Shibutani's were gaining momentum even through last year's World Championships. They placed in the top five, had though they did have that Blue Danube free dance, which wasn't the greatest for them. It certainly didn't work the wonders that Fix You did for them. But Maddie and Evan were able to sort of coast a safe distance above the Shibutani's, and the Shibutani's said, hey, not so fast. And then this happens, and I'd say have usurped Maddie and Evan as the top US Ice Dance team, and I know, knowing Maddie especially, and Evan, they're not gonna go down as the top US Ice Dance team without a fight, and they're not gonna let this phase them. And they're still world medalists, and they put together two fantastic programs. They're such a talented team. And I hope they don't see this season as a forgettable one or a letdown for them. I think, much like the Shibutani's, they can use it, like you said, Kathy, as a springboard for even better material. About their programs, though, it was a shame that they had that whole went through the ringer with their short dance. I mean, that was just a mess, and you wouldn't wish that upon anyone. But the free dance I want to talk about, even here in Boston, when it should have been, I think, at its peak and at its height in terms of performance and execution, I don't know, their free dance just still doesn't quite do it for me. It didn't quite do it for me in Boston. And it's lovely. It has lovely moments. It has lovely lifts. It is a world class. The skating itself in the program is world class, obviously. But something about the structure of the program, and I think that's the big difference between Maddie Evans' free dance and the Shibutani's free dance, is there wasn't a clear structure to Maddie and Evans' free dance, and the music cuts didn't really build the way you wanted them to. It was sort of one note for the first like three quarters of the free dance, and it doesn't grab you and keep you for the end. But the way the Shibutani's program was structured was masterful. It grabbed your attention and it kept you all the way to the end, and they had you on your side by the end of those 4 minutes. And Maddie and Evan really do need something like that next season if they're going to want to restake their claim as the best US ice dance team. But still, really, really great job for them, these World Championships, finishing out with that bronze medal. What did you guys think of Maddie and Evan?
I just think I agree with you about the programs. The big issue for me is that their free dance this season is forgettable. And because we've seen them have good programs in the past, American in Paris was actually a really good program for them. It was such a good vehicle, and it was really memorable. I still remember like the lift in the middle of the program where she's like the Statue of Liberty, whereas I struggled to really remember moments from this program. And I honestly think they can do a lot better than that. I think that they are really talented, and I think with better material, I think that they should try to stick along the vein of, like, an American Paris type thing, because the Rachmaninoff was just not really working as well. There were definitely, they performed it well, it's just, it wasn't quite as good and as compared to the Shibutani's this season. They needed something as good as American Paris was. That said, there's no way that they go down easily. I see them coming back with a vengeance next season, but I don't know what I was trying to say there, but I definitely see them coming back with a vengeance next season. And I really can't wait to see what programs they put out, especially because the next season's short dance is going to allow hip-hop, and we saw in their exhibition, Maddie Chott can do hip-hop, and like Beyonce and stuff like that. So I'm really excited to see if they actually go along with that, because I think that could be really good, especially coming from them. Otherwise, yeah, I think this was a very solid season for them. I know it wasn't and I feel like I say this a lot, it wasn't what they were looking for. They were looking to challenge the Shibutani's to try to beat them after Four Continents and Nationals, and that didn't end up happening. But I think there's a lot to be proud of from this season, and I also think there's a lot they can take away and improve on for next season.
Yeah, I definitely agree with you guys about their free dance. It's just not as memorable as I would like it to be for such an iconic piece of music. Yeah. You know, we've seen so many teams in and single skaters skate to Rock 2 that it's like you have to add something to the repertoire. You have to contribute, I think, something unique and new and innovative for it to stand out, you know, in the, I think, long-term picture of skating. But I, you know, I still wouldn't count them out, you know, given everything that they've accomplished. I think that for U.S. Ice Dance as a whole, the rivalry sort of between the Shibs and Chalk and Bates is a really good thing in the long run. I think that the fact that we've seen them switch places in subsequent seasons, I think, is a really a testament to how close they are in terms of what they can achieve. I wouldn't say they are very similar in style. Mm-hmm. In fact, I would say they're pretty different. I think that the Shibutani's rely on the strength of their skating and the sort of power that they generate, both in terms of the technical side and in terms of how they capture music and mm-hmm. the strength of their character portrayals, whereas Chalk and Bates create more of a mood. Their programs are sort of big picture. They're about storytelling. And Bronwyn mentioned their American in Paris program. I think that that was a really hard program to follow up to, I think, because it was so their lifts were great. They were it was just memorable in the sense that you could even taken out of context, you could appreciate it in its entirety. Whereas I think that their free dance this season doesn't quite live up to that. But again, you know, a new season, new material, and I think that the goal for them now is just going to finding music that both of them, I think, can connect with and interpret equally. And I think that we talked about this a little bit at the beginning of the season, but their lifts this season they look a little bit more labored than mm-hmm. they did last season. Obviously, they have new lifts, new positions. Everything is they have to learn it from scratch, and we admire them for constantly, you know, putting out new things, but it doesn't seem to have gotten better over the season. They still the lifts aren't as smooth as I would like to see. You can see them pausing between positions. You can see them sort of almost be hesitant, and that's, you know, again, that's me nitpicking because they're already so great that you know, anything they can do to improve is just carry on top of it. Anything they can do to improve is just icing on top of the cake. But again, not certainly things they could work on in the future, and especially if they want to keep that rivalry going and perhaps try to overtake the Shubutanis again.
Now let's move on to our fourth place finishers, Anna Cavallini and Luca Lannotte from Italy. It was a bit of a disappointment to see them so far down in the standings after the short dance. Especially for them, I feel like they're every season, well, not every season, but last season in particular, and this season, they were a bit of a dark horse. Like, you cannot count them out. And I think they proved that with this free dance. They skated really, really well, and they moved up after their short dance. But I do think they're going to be able to want to get back to the form that they were in 2014 when they basically tied for that gold medal, but they won it all themselves, but that gold medal at the World Championships. But what I love about Anna and Luca is that their skating and their basics are so sound, and they use that to its greatest capacity, I think. They have such seamless depth of edge, and their holds are really close, and they check all the boxes for what you want out of a technically sound ice dance team. Nothing is wrong. I just feel like it's disappointing that for them that they're not on the podium regularly in big competitions like the World Championships. I mean, they did well at Grand Prix Final and were second to Papadakis and Cizeron at Europeans. But I think they need to, next season, just skate with a little bit more purpose and desire. Not that they're not doing that already, but even more so. I feel like that'll only do wonders for them and propel them towards the very, very top of the standings. They have everything they need. They're so good, and they're literally right there. So I'm excited to see what they do for the future. What did you guys think of Anna and Luca?
I agree with you. Last season, they tried to experiment a little more. They did their Danse Macabre.
Not my favorite.
Yeah, it wasn't really... It didn't work out for them. Mm-hmm. So they returned to what they knew. And it's what they know is, like, charming. It's, you know, that classic look. They rely on kind of that. It's kind of like a glamorous look. And, like, it kind of reminds me of their 2014 short dance to 42nd Street. And I really like that program. And I think this works for them. I would like to see them try to do something a little different. They don't need to be super experimental or anything, but it would be interesting to see them try to step back out of their comfort zone now that they've kind of returned to it, you know? That said, this does work really, really well for them. And it's nice for them to know that they always have this in their wheelhouse if they need to return to it. And like you said, well, their basics are just so strong. They are both such strong skaters, and they are able to make it look really easy, you know? I'm definitely a big fan of theirs, and they're definitely, like, they just seem so natural together. Like, it feels like they belong together on the ice, and there's not really a big disparity between the two in terms of ability, in my opinion. I think they are just a really strong unit. And I really would like to see where they go from here, because they're still trying to get back on the podium, because they haven't made the world podium since they won it in 2014. So that's kind of where I'm at. I think they're good. I would really like to see them elevate into great, you know?
I think what I appreciate most about Anna and Luca is how reliable they are. It's, you know, time after time, you can pretty much expect them to skate up to par and not make any fluke mistakes because they're just so consistent. But the flip side of that is that it's really hard for them once they sort of get into that rut of placing just under the podium. It's hard for them to advance because they are getting such similar results time after time. But, you know, I think it's important to remember that, like, at this point in their career, it's At the beginning of the season, I talked about how I wish their programs were a little bit more innovative, more experimental. But, you know, I have to remind myself that, you know, at this point in their career, they really don't need to prove anything to anyone because they are so experienced and we know they have the techniques and the goods to back up whatever, you know, music they choose to skate to, whereas younger teens might not have the luxury of, like you said, Bronwyn, falling back on that basis, on that sort of brand of skating that you know you can do so well. And so I wouldn't say it was totally convincing or successful, their free dance from last season to Dance Macabre, but I enjoyed it for the fact that it was something different from them. And so there's the two sides of that. There's the side of me that wants them to keep pushing the boundary and breaking out of their comfort zone, and the part of me that knows that that is happy with the fact that they know their strengths and they know what they can produce. And so there's value to both things. And so I think that striking a balance is key for them going forward. And depending on whether or not they're shooting for 2018, I mean, I think it's safe to assume that they are at this point because we're getting pretty close to the next Olympics. I think that, like you guys said, their main goal for the short term would be getting back on top of those podiums, maybe winning their Grand Prix events, you know, winning possibly Europeans, although Papadakis and Cizeron will certainly be tough to challenge. And I think that they're just a team that is really enjoyable to watch, and you know that you know sort of what to expect from them season after season, and in a way that is its own kind of comfort and kind of I don't know what I'm trying to say. In a way that is its own kind of strength for them, and I think it could work in their favor.
Definitely, definitely. I'm excited to see what they'll do next season with their programs. Also excited to see what Weaver and Poge, the highest-placing Canadian dance team, will do next season. You know, I love this team. I love them so much. I think they're so expressive, and they have such an innate inclination for movement and just being and dancing with each other. They're also very natural together, much like Anna and Luca. I think they're very well matched. But I have to say, this was a bit of a surprising result here. They looked like, given, you know, they defeated the Shibutanis at Skate Canada, and they were on the same upward trajectory that they were on last season. But again, like we saw last season, I don't think they tapered off. I think they got stronger towards the end of the season, just not as strong as everyone else has improved over the course of the season. Does that make sense?
No, that makes sense.
You know, because like the Shibutanis, like, just improved leaps and bounds, and Gabriella and Guillaume are just brilliant, and Anna and Luca and Maddie and Evan, they just steadily improve. Whereas I feel like Caitlin and Andrew, like, they start off so strong, but that isn't always the greatest thing, because what do you have to work from? And I do think, though, that there has been a great evolution in their programs this year, though. That being said, their free dance has really grown on me. It was always pretty. It was always pretty, but I think towards the end of the season it gained purpose and drive. And I really hope they're not discouraged by this, because they're such a talented team. I would like to see them I would like to see them experiment at this point, because I think they're, unlike Anna and Luca, I feel like they're at a different sort of crossroads. Like, do we do what we've been doing, or do we experiment? And I think it's time for them to experiment, because I think judges will appreciate that. Especially with things like their short dance. Their short dance never really was my favorite. I mean, it was not, again, it was nice and it was pretty and it was aesthetically pleasing and it was everything they're good at. And the same thing with their free dance, which I prefer to their short dance. But they're similar to what they've been doing, and I would just like to see them do more. What do you guys have to say about them?
I completely agree, especially with the short dance. It didn't stand out at all, and I was like, I know they had to change it because they had the Elvis Presley short dance at the beginning, and we saw that a lot, people having to change around their short dance, as we talked about. And I thought the Elvis short dance, although it didn't really work with the waltz, I thought it was more interesting. And then, like, being told, oh, that's not a waltz, and you have to go and scramble. We saw the same thing with Maddie and Evan changing from Dark Eyes to their new short dance. But I do think the season was kind of a disappointment to them because Grand Prix Final, they got stronger. Canadian Nationals, they got stronger. And then the wheels sort of fell off at Four Continents when they had struggles. The free dance was really rough at Four Continents. They fell all the way to bronze, which was definitely disappointing for them. And so they were kind of coming in with a chip on their shoulder after Worlds, and they had a lot of ground to make up to try to catch up to not only Maddie and Evan and the ships, but also you had Papadakis' Aron and Anna and Luca, just all these different teams who have only gotten stronger. Like you said, they kind of stagnated a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why I'm like, I definitely agree that they should probably try to experiment more. I really like their style. It's right up my alley, but you can't, you know, you don't want to see a team doing the same thing over and over when they haven't been at the forefront for that long. Like, Anna and Luca have been around for a while, and Weaver and Poche have been around for longer than most teams, but they also haven't exactly, like, been a lot around the block very long. So I definitely agree with pretty much everything you said. I just think that some sort of experimentation will definitely help them out in the future because I think that's what they need at this point in their career.
I think that Will kind of touched on this earlier, but it's probably an issue that they're peaking too early. Is how we can explain this World Championships and last year's World Championships. Although I would argue that they were underscored at mm-hmm. last year's Worlds, and I thought, I thought they should have been the winners. But regardless, I think that this season we definitely saw them sort of lose momentum coming into this competition, and that's so important in a discipline like ice dance where the positions, the placements don't shift around as much as in the other disciplines. So it's almost like people have these expectations coming in, and sometimes it can be, you know, a self-fulfilling prophecy. And, you know, I wonder what their mindset was coming into this competition. I wonder if they wanted it too much because they know that last year they were so close to challenging for the title. And so going forward, I think my concern for them is just knowing how to pace themselves throughout the season so that they are at they're not just peaking, you know, on the Grand Prix circuit, which has always been their strength, but that they're sort of saving their energy so that they can be at their best for every competition, especially later in the season where the stakes are higher.
Definitely, definitely. Let's move on to, quickly, Hubbell and Donahue, the sixth-place team here in this field. They a breakout season for them. I mean, they have just been so, so good this season, and they had the same result at U.S. Nationals. They had the like similar results at U.S. Nationals and at generally their international competitions, but their skating doesn't show for that. I mean, their skating, they've improved so much. I don't know. I think I'm so excited to see where they go because this was really just like the ideal breakout season. I mean, top six in the world in this like field of ice dancers in which politics probably play the biggest role. They've broken through, I'd say. Defeating Piper and Paul, which honestly for this team almost seemed insurmountable a couple of seasons ago. And even defeating Penny and Nick. They just have had such an exceptional year. And I can't wait to see where they go. Any thoughts on them?
I agree with you. They have my favorite short dance of the season, hands down.
Yeah.
Oh my god, it's so good. There's just so much emotion. And they make a non-traditional waltz music. They make it work, and it sounds natural. It's not like Pop Doc Essence is their own, where it's not. It doesn't seem as organic. They took music that wasn't organic and made it organic. And kudos to whoever cut their music. I think they did an exceptional job doing their music for the short dance, and they did an exceptional job skating it. I think the coaching change from to Montreal was the best thing that happened for them so far. Mm-hmm. And last season, they were kind of a shaky number three, as like they were like, okay, you know, we don't really have, like, they're still the number three team, but it was like, you know, it was kind of like by default.
Hawaiik and Baker were scratching the surface, I think.
Yeah, they were, and Hawaiik and Baker did have more struggles this season that kind of set them back, but, you know, they solidified their place. Yes. There is no one who could take that from them now, honestly. I just think that now they, I think what to do, what they can look for next is to try to push up even further in the ranks, maybe try to push past one of Chalk and Bates or the Shibutanis. I don't know. I don't know what to expect from them now, just because I know that there's more they can give after this season. I know they are not done, but at the same time, it's like, I really want them to push past, but because they're U.S. number three, I don't know if that'll actually happen or not, because like you said, politics play such a big role. I really hope they can, though. They are just, they've improved so much. Their free dance is really good. Their short dance was amazing. I just can't, I'm so excited to see what's next for them, because this was just such a huge season for them.
I see Hubble and Donahue as kind of being in the same position that the Shibutanis were in about 2 years ago, where they were firmly in third place, but it didn't look like it looked like it would take a lot for them to move past. So I think that at this point, you know, it looks like it's gonna be really, really hard for Maddie and Zach to surpass their rivals, but that doesn't account for how much progress they've made in such little time. And I think that their programs are more compelling than ever before, especially that shore dance. It's so stunning and so just passionate in a way that's it seems very natural, and it doesn't seem forced at all. It seems like the natural chemistry between them is really being harnessed through their movements. And that's always, you know, that's what you look for in ice dance. That's the essence of the sport, pretty much. But that's where I see them being right now in terms of the other U.S. ice dance teams. Am I hopeful for their future? Definitely, because the fact that they have made such great strides tells me that they can do even more. And so I'm looking forward to seeing they've never been a boring team to begin with. Their programs have always been very interesting. Their costumes too. I remember in 2011, I believe, Maddie had the dress that was like black and white leopard spots with the rainbow skirt. Kind of a side note, but they've always been capable of capturing our attention, regardless of their placement. So I think that that's not an issue for them, and it's just going to be about working on those technical elements. Their short dance has been strong, obviously, all season, but they've sort of struggled, I think, a bit more with the free dance, just because they're not, in my opinion, taking full advantage of the levels that they could be getting. So, but that's an easy fix compared to more abstract things like artistry or interpretation or performance. So I think I am pretty optimistic about them going forward, and I definitely wish them the best because they're so deserving of what they earned so far, and I know they can do even better.
Definitely, definitely. Anything else to say about the ice dancers or the men?
No, I think we are all set.
So stay tuned, because this is only the first part of our world recap. There will be a second part.
We had too much to talk about.
Yeah, we couldn't fit it all in one podcast. It would be literally 3 hours long. So for Let's and Glory, I'm Will.
I'm Kathy.
And I'm Bronwyn, and don't forget to follow us on Twitter, at Lutz and Glory, and don't forget to subscribe if you like our videos. We will try to put out more content. Even though the season's over, we'll definitely try to put out more than we have been recently, but definitely stay tuned because we've got a lot coming for you. Thanks for watching. Bye.
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 Into four.
Do I stay? Do I dare?
Will you take your place with me?